Hello, my name is Lasse Havernen and this is Web Development Frameworks 2021.
Then about the function syntax. Classical JavaScript syntax is like this, like we have been using. So you have the keyword function, then you have the function name, then you can have some parameters, etc. Okay, here is some ready to go examples. So this is in the function syntax, folder the first file one basics.js. So this is the classical function syntax. In JavaScript, you can also use syntax, not syntax, but functions in the same way as you use any other variable. So you can assign it into, assign a function for a variable, and then you can pass that function, for example, into another function, or you can create an object which properties do not have primitive types as values. They don't have, they are not normal objects, but they are functions. So you can have basically a function collection in an object. And that is already what we did when we were doing some of the object thing. So we had some properties which value were actually a function, and that function can have access to the other properties in that object, for example. So this is same or another way how to express a function. So you can have a function name and then you assign to it a function with this syntax. So this is basically called anonymous function on its own, since as you can see, it is just a function keyword without any name here. So it is an anonymous function. But you can call it, when you have assigned an anonymous function to a variable, then of course it's no longer anonymous, you have a name for it, so then you can call it. And as I said, you can also assign a function. So here we have this my name function, which is being assigned into another name. And then when you call this another name, you are calling this function here. And you can also give functions as parameters. So here is an example of that. Here is a function which prints out the type of the parameter which was given to it. So this function takes one parameter, p, and then it simply prints out the type of that parameter. So here we have this function, this print parameter type, and the parameter for this function is now another function with the name my name. So we are giving this function here as parameter to this function. So this is here just to illustrate that you can indeed work with functions in the same way what you can do with primitive types or these objects, which you are maybe more familiar with. Then when passing these function names or passing functions as parameters to other functions, you should be aware of that. What is the signification of these normal brackets, which mean that you want to call the function. So here we have a function called example. We are assigning it to another name called another example. And then we are calling type of another example. Here is almost identical piece of code, but the only difference is that now here is this, we are using these normal brackets, which trigger the function call. And instead of assigning this function here, we are assigning the return value of the example function here. And therefore the type of this one is not a function, but a string. So let's see if we execute this one. So here this first output 6 is for this one. This is the what you should already know pretty well, calling a function, giving some parameters. Then here we have this my name function, which was assigned here, and then we are calling it like so. So John Doe, okay, so it's printing out John Doe. then here my name is being assigned to the another name, and another name is being called with Donald Duck, and it is printed out because we are executing this function here. Then we have three calls to the print parameter type function. First one with value 2, second one with string hello world, and third one with function my name. And the outputs are like so. So number, string, function. This is the one which is executed. And then here is the illustration of what the difference between having these brackets at the end of function name and not having means is that you have a function call here. Whereas here where you don't have the brackets, you are passing the reference to the function here. And therefore this first console output will print function here, and this second will actually print string because the example function returns here a string. Okay, here are the same things. Okay, then something about function scope. Are you familiar with the function scope? What does it mean? Here is this file, so second example in the repository. So here we have some code. We are creating a variable a with value 5. Then we are creating a function example. And inside this function example, we have some a new variable, a constant variable b created with value 10. And then we are printing out the sum of a, b, and param 1. And example 20 works. Why does it work? We are here accessing, inside a function, we are accessing this one, which is not present here inside this function. B was created here, and param 1 was given as parameter, but A is not here. Why can we access A? So basically, what it means is that you have a so-called function scope, which you can think about that is the area between these curly brackets here. The code what you have inside here has access to that, to any variable which has been declared here, and it has also access to a level above this one, so the so-called parent lexical scope. This function has also access to any variable declared or function declared inside here, and also one level above it. And now this level above here is this this file level. In this Node programming language, it's this module scope. So therefore we can access this A, and it will output this 20, 35, when we give 20 here. So 20 as parameter 1, B as 10, and A as 5, so it will output 35. But then if we here at this, in this case, we are running this Node.js, so we are running on this so-called module level here. So here at this module root level, we are executing console log B. But since B was declared here inside this function, we don't have access to it. Here it says B is not defined in global scope. But this global scope term is actually a little bit incorrect, since we are dealing with only things which are inside this file. Okay, so then if we think about something known as function closure, is maybe best way explained, maybe if I try to draw a little bit here, let's see. But let's first see what is happening here on this code. This tries to illustrate a closure. So there is a function greetings to you. Here there is a comment which says this is an outer function. Anyhow, we have a function here in this file called greetings to you. And if we minimize that one, we can see that what is happening here. We are calling this function. We are giving one parameter to it, Dear Lasse, my name. Greetings to you indeed accepts one parameter, and then it returns us something. And here on the next line, we are calling with these normal brackets, this one. So obviously what this returns here, it must be a function. So this function, greetings to you, will return a function, which is then stored here to the greeter, and then we can call it. Then when we execute greeter Christmas, greeter New Year, greeter day, it will output Merry Christmas Lasse. Here it will output Merry Happy New Year and here have a nice day. So let's execute this one. So this kind of output is given. It first is like so. So this one is the output of this one, and this one is the output of this one. Here is the output of this one. So what you see on the screen is now basically a closure in operation. And as you can see, some way this greeter function here has a memory of what was given previously, right? This Lasse was passed only to greetings to you, and we received a greeter here, but some way this greeter function, what they call here, here, and here, it some way has a memory of the name given. So if I put here another name, you can see that the name changes, so it is not hard-coded. So obviously this function somehow has a memory of what was given here. So let's see now what is happening inside. Greetings to you. So this is the code what is inside greetings to you. So first there is a constant with the name created at being created, and it's a simply a new date object. Then there is a function being defined. So as you can see, you can define functions inside functions, and this function is given a name season selector. So this can be called a so-called inner function since this is inside this function. Okay, so what does season selector do? It takes one parameter, name as type, and then here is a switch case statement. It checks what is the type of this, what is the content of this type parameter. If it is Christmas, New Year, or day, it executes these things. And as you can see here, it says, if the type is Christmas, it's gonna print out Merry Christmas and then the name. And the name was given as a parameter here in the so-called outer function, this greetings to you. And greetings to you is now the function inside which this one is now defined. And then as a last step, this was just a function definition, season selector. And here, this function, season selector, is being returned from greetings to you. So because the season selector is now returned, here, this greeter has now the return value of this function. So greeter is basically now this season selector function, right? Does it make any sense? So yeah, we are returning a function from a function, and therefore we can use the return value here. And because in the same way as in the previous example, as I said, that a function has access to its own values and also to the values, meaning variables and other functions defined one level above it. So now this function is defined here. It is using this name variable, which is a parameter given to greetings to you. So it is using this here. So obviously, when we execute this function here, somehow it can still access the value here. And this is what is called closure. So closure is basically the fact that a function can access variables and methods, I mean functions declared one level above it. That is a closure. So even though we execute the greetings to you only once here, the scope of the greetings to you is kept alive by the JavaScript engine, the Node.js in this case. As long as this greeter exists, because here this greeter can be executed, and the greeter is another name for the season selector, and season selector can access the name here. So that's the way how it goes. And this is indeed a closure. So if you get into some kind of interview for maybe job posting and they ask that what is a closure, in my opinion, the correct answer would be that you can explain that a function has access to the scope of one level above own. And this is the way how it's visible in practice. Okay, so let's see, can you now apply this in practice? Here is an exercise to you. So you should write a closure to multiply numbers with function multiplier, as seen here. And your solution should pass all these codes. So here is a little bit testing code. There should be this kind of function defined multiplier, which you can give values, let's say 2, 6, and 15. So if you create a multiplier with parameter 2, you receive this one, multiplier 2. And then when you call multiplier 2 and give value 2 to it as a parameter, the outcome should be 2 times 2, which is 4. If you give 7 to multiplier 2, the outcome here in the B should be 14, so 7 times 2. If you give 32 to multiplier 2, the outcome should be 64. If you have multiplier 6, then these are the outcomes here. If you have multiplier 15, then it should return these. So you should now create this kind of multiplier function, which can operate like so. And you can see the exercise template here. So if you go to function syntax, then here exercises, and here one closure. So here is now the template. And you can try to execute and see what happens. Node function exercises one closure. Yeah, okay, first it says multiplier not defined. So that's the first thing to do. So you should write your code here, your solution, so that whatever you have written here between this and this comment line should work so that it can pass these tests that are here. The assert function will check that if this is false, then it will print this one. So basically, if A is, for example, value 5, then this text will be printed out. If A is 4, then it will not print anything. So assert is like a test. You can check that does something match, and if not, then you can print some value, some string. The key requirement is that this multiplier must return a function so that we can call it. So and then it should accept one parameter here. So for example, value. So now obviously it should return now some function. You can, for example, give it here a name that, okay, maybe the function name would be calculator, and then we can define the function calculator here. So you are returning the function calculator. So basically these are now that function calculators. And then if we see, we must be able to call it with single parameter. We can name the parameter, for example, X. And now, since the idea is that these are now the calculator functions, so if we pass here 32, it would multiply this one with the parameter that was given to the original multiplier function here. So basically it means that we want to multiply this X with the value. Like so. Did you do something similar? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what is the name of this? Function exercises. Now there is no output. So I guess it works. You could add here. Yeah. Next topic, what we have. So arrow functions, and this is a pretty important thing in this JavaScript primer, since it will be used a lot when you are doing some React program, and also basically any kind of JavaScript programming these days. So the idea with arrow syntax is illustrated in this example. So here at the first, we have this traditional function syntax. We have the function keyword, then we have the parameters in normal brackets, and then we have the curly brackets here, and then inside that we have the function body, which is executed. And the arrow syntax comes in a couple of different variations. Here are these three variations, what you typically, or what the syntax supports. So this function here is exactly the same as is this one. So the main difference is that, as you can see, there is no function keyword here in the beginning. Otherwise, this looks exactly the same as this one. Oh, sorry. Yeah, of course, here is then this kind of arrow symbol. So equals, and then this, what is this, larger than, or right arrow symbol. So these two combined, you have an arrow, and the keyword function here in the beginning has been replaced with this arrow symbol. You can also have a shorter variation of this arrow function, which is visible here. The difference here with this one and then this one is that, as you can see, there is no curly brackets here in this function body. And also the return statement, return keyword, is missing. But from the syntax point of view, this one means exactly the same as this one. So the result, whatever you write here, result of this operation will be returned from this function and is then available in this. And you can even do it in a more short version, especially if you don't need multiple parameters to your function. If you have only single parameter, then you can get rid of even these brackets. And then you have it like this. So this is now a function parameter. This is the function body. And the result of this one will be returned from this function. There is also another difference with this arrow syntax. It is not just a syntax difference, but there is also some difference in behavior. And that difference in behavior is related to on how the keyword this behaves. You have seen the keyword this being used in JavaScript. What is the value of the this is a little bit confusing in certain scenarios. It is not always so clear. There is good documentation on it, but on how to remember that what is the exact value of this in every scenario can be a little bit difficult. And it can cause some problems which can be quite difficult to debug if you are not totally sure what is the value of this in each scenario. It is maybe the best way, it is maybe evident when you have some asynchronous functions like what you can see here. This is now taken directly from the Mozilla documentation, but we can explore it a little bit. We copy, for example, this one and create here a new file. Okay, so what is happening here? It's basically a constructor function person, which is used to initialize some property age to an object with the value 0. Then set interval is being called. Are you familiar with set interval? This will start up a timer which executes the function given as first parameter here with the interval of this many milliseconds, so 1000 milliseconds. And if we run this code, you might expect that, okay, the age will be increased by 1 between every 1000 milliseconds, right? Because there is the this.age and it is here. What do you think happens here when we execute it? Okay, there is no output. Let's see. It prints something known as none. Do you know what none is? Yeah, not a number. Why does it do like this? Clearly, age is a number, right? So why would it behave like this? Okay, we can take this one also here away. So anonymous function, not a number. If we would have, we comment this out. So with the P up, it works. Like so. But then when we have the interval thing there, it says not a number. And this is exactly the kind of bugs which you end up with when you are relying on the keyword this to perform certain scenarios and you are not 100% sure that what is exactly the value of this in each scenario. Let's see if we put here in the beginning console log statements. I will delete this from the single up call. Okay. So as you can see, when we print out that what is this, when we call this dot up here, the result is a person object. When we print out the value of this inside this function in the set interval, it is not a person object. It is a timeout object. Do you know why this happens? So basically, maybe I can try to illustrate that if we draw some kind of execution flow diagram here. This is the starting point of the JavaScript engine when it starts this one. So what happens here is that when it starts to parse this file, it will first go here and it will create this here on the line one. It will create this person object. Then it will go on and execute this one. So there is the new P. P, and then it goes on and creates the up. I mean, executes the P up. Like so. And when it created this person object here, it basically started the interval, the timer running. And then this one, after executing this P up, it goes back. And where it goes back now is the what is the correct term? Let's say JavaScript main execution loop, where it is running the execution loop. The engine is running basically on idle, and it is seeing if there are any events. If no, it is just looping there in the idle in the main execution loop. And from that point of view, this person object is no longer available. It is not in the same context. Then after 1000 milliseconds being in that execution loop, there is this timer event. The timer event is being triggered, and then it executes this function here. And at that point, when it executes this function, the keyword this does not refer anymore to the person object, but it refers to the timer event itself. And therefore, you cannot access the age from the person object anymore. Because it is no longer available. And it is all because of how the this keyword is assigned a value. And this is one of the things which the arrow syntax was also created to fix. Because from a programmer point of view, this kind of behavior is quite confusing. When you use arrow syntax, then modify to the set interrupt function to use an arrow syntax function and execute it again. And now you can see it is working. So the arrow syntax is not just a different way of writing the same thing, but it has a significant behavior difference regarding on how this keyword is being treated. Because of this, I really recommend that you use the arrow syntax as much as possible, because that way you can avoid problems with that one. There is something also known as the bind, which could be used to fix the situation like it was before, but it is overly complicated and easy to forget, in my opinion. So the bind method in a function creates a new function that when it is called, it has this keyword set to the provided value, whatever you gave to the bind. So this you could get the traditional function to run in the same way as what you do with the arrow syntax, but it is very easy to forget to do the bind, and then when you forget it, you can have some unexpected bugs in the program. So that is one of the differences in the arrow syntax. How is the keyword this being mapped? Okay, there is a small exercise for you again. So now there is a file with this name. There is again the car class being used, what we have used already before. Now it has been modified so that it also has a method called keyboard input demo, which has this kind of code. So it accepts keyboard input from you. The idea with the keyboard input is again to show that how you can use the this keyword to access some data inside the object itself when you have some asynchronous methods. So let's see the exercise file itself here and here. So function syntax exercises, and I think it's this one, not the solutions. And then the file two arrow functions this.js. So it has the class car. This is the same car what we have been using earlier. Now there is this keyboard input demo. And what this does is that it hooks into your keyboard, and then when there is an event of key press, then a function is executed. And inside that function, we try to print out the name of the property brand from this car object alongside with your key press, whatever it is. So when you run this, like so it first calls the display speed, increase speed, display speed, so the speed is 5, so this works there just fine. Then we have the keyboard input demo, which has set an event listener for a key press, as seen here. And then when we press a key, then we try to execute this function. And this function tries to access the brand property here, just for demo purposes, and then it also prints out the key. But the name of the brand is undefined. So now your task is to modify this code here so that you could access the brand here instead of having it undefined. So to fix this one, You need to modify this function to be an arrow function or to set it to use the bind. I will start with the bind example since to use that one, it should be a this kind of classical function instead of arrow function. So the bind is a method for a function. So therefore, you call it from a function. So the function body is here. So when I put a dot there, I can use the bind. And then for this bind, I can now provide whatever value I want to be the value of this inside the function when it calls or when it's called. So
yeah.
I want it to be this. Since at the moment when this function is created, this is now referring to an instance of this class.
Yeah.
Therefore, I will put this to the value of the bind and modify it like so. Now, when I execute it, when I put some keyboard here, I can see that I can access this in a correct manner since the Audi text is being printed as it is here referred from the brand property of this. So that is the way how you would use the this, I mean the bind in this case. If done with the arrow function, there is no need for the bind. Simply modify the function to use the arrow function syntax, delete the function keyword, and then add the arrow syntax there. Save, execute, and then it works.